Good morning, and welcome to worship this morning. It's good to see you all. I have just a couple of brief announcements to share with you, and then we have a couple, but we'll keep it as brief as we can. Next Sunday after church, I'm going to invite anyone who is interested in the concept of education here in our church. Now, we're forming an education focus team that you can be a part of it or not. But if you are curious about or interested in how education is handled in the church at all ages, I'm going to invite you to come in the lounge for a time of discussion next Sunday. I'm going to lead that one, but after that, it's going to be turned over to others. But I think it's important enough for us to get together and talk about that. What would you like to see happening here in regards to how we educate our youth? That's changed, hasn't it? A lot of change in the last couple of years. What do we offer for adults in the way of Bible study and education opportunities, that kind of thing? Bringing others in to talk in like a fellowship time or something like that. So I'd be very much interested. This comes out of our CAT, the CAT survey, in which we were told this is a major concern to you folks. So I want to get that ball rolling here before we get much further in the year. So invite you. That will be the subject of that particular Sunday. We'll return to talking about the other one we were on, the mission and vision team, a little later. But I wanted to get the education one going. So that'll be next Sunday, right after church. Get some coffee and some treats. We won't keep you long. I just want to get that discussion going and try to understand better what it is that the concerns and desires of you folks, so that we'll have that opportunity. We also are coming up on our Thanksgiving program, our dinner here, and there's a sign-up sheet right outside here that they're looking for folks to indicate they'll do this or supply that or be involved. And Leslie, did you want to say anything about it at all?
That's me.
That's you. Okay. Well, we'll go to you then, Nancy. Nancy's going to talk to us about that. You got to push the thing up.
It's on.
Okay.
It is on. First of all, you all have been hearing about our 44th annual free Thanksgiving dinner here in our church for the community. Before I talk about this year, please, Leslie and Dwayne Youngstead, could you stand up, please? Where is Dwayne? There we go. Yes. About 15 years ago, Leslie and Dwayne agreed to help June Peterson, who had run it for a long, long time. They decided that they would help out. We thank you for all of those years. They unfortunately are moving away from us, and it is taking seven of us to be trained to learn what the two of them have done for all this time. So thank you, and thank you. We definitely appreciate that. There are seven of us who are trying to learn how to do this. We need lots of volunteers for the next couple of weeks. Shopping starts next weekend. The 15 turkeys arrive into our refrigerators next weekend. The week of Thanksgiving, though, there is a lot of activity here. If you have an hour, if you have more than an hour, please, please come over and help us out. There is a chart out in the narthex that talks about it. Monday, we do relish. Tuesday, the turkeys are cooked and carved. We need lots of help then. Wednesday, the potatoes are peeled, cut up, and they actually get cooked on Thursday. But also Wednesday, we set up the tables. And then on Thursday, obviously, we need lots of help for the day. We need drivers. We need servers. We need lots of help on Thursday. Clean up. And also, Leslie's always favorite commercial is we need more pies. So please, if you can bake a pie or two, that's also on the chart. We need quite a few. So thank you. Let us know if you can help.
Angel, you have some announcements?
First of all, I want to thank those that have already dropped off some really nice boxes to me. We have 9 of them already for our Operation Christmas Child. So thank you, those that have packed. I'm going to start with a poem. "'Twas the night before National Collection Week, when all through the land, Connect volunteers were praying for a week that would be grand. The relay centers were ready, excited to start. They'd waited all year to play a very important part in bringing millions of shoeboxes to children far and wide, whose happiness and joy would be hard to hide. Packing parties were all planned. Shoeboxes are waiting to be filled. Many goodies have been purchased, as you see my mess by my office. Oh, where did I go? These children would be thrilled. There'd be hygiene items and school supplies, clothing and toys too. These children would be so happy, they wouldn't know what to do. But that wasn't all. The greatest gift was still to come, when the children would learn in whose name all these gifts were really from. They'd learn about a Savior whose gift was free for all. And yet this gift was more valuable than anything you could buy at a mall. They'd learn about the King Jesus and be invited back for more. And if they accepted, the greatest journey was in store. They'd learn about the Bible and how to share their new faith with others. They'd learn that in God's great family, every one of us are sisters and brothers. And from this simple shoebox, many lives would change for good. And churches would be built where once only rubble and tents had stood. And churches would be, And that's why we bring packed shoeboxes to drop-off locations this week, because we want to share Jesus with others, the one every hopeless heart should seek. So bring us all your boxes, wrapped or unwrapped, we don't care. It's not about the gifts inside, it's the good news and great joy we want to share. And when the week is finished and the work is almost through, we'll be amazed by all the boxes, knowing that this is something only God can do. So a reminder, our packing party here at the church is Saturday at 2 p.m. Come join us. We've got a lot to pack. My stepmom and I think we'll get 150 boxes packed. Thank you.
So that's a great opportunity. We've been doing that for some years now, and we increase the numbers in boxes, it seems, every year. So that's a wonderful opportunity for people to be engaged in. There's other announcements I invite you to take a look at in your bulletin when you have the opportunity. And just a very brief moment on stewardship in our church. As we are working on this next year, it's a little bit more difficult to do, because when we do our budgeting in the finance committee and on, we don't just look at expenditures, we look at anticipated income. That's how budgets are done. You know, you have to say, well, we're going to spend this amount of money, potentially. Where will the money come from to support that? And so what we have done is we've looked at what has been the traditional giving in this church through offering, year after year, and we do about a three-year average or so, and say, well, here's about how much we can expect, and then where will the, because there's more cost than that, where will that come from? And we have some investments that we figure into that. But one of the big parts of planning is how you tell us you're going to give. So that's why we ask for pledges. Now, you don't have to. There's no obligation. We have had as many as a little over 100 people pledge, families, at one time. We've been down as low as 60 or so, and it usually falls somewhere in there. But the idea of pledging is that it helps us say, here's the confidence we have in our income side. It doesn't mean that we approach it differently than some places do. Some places will say, well, here's how much money we got to spend. Now, where can we go and spend that? We actually start on the other side and say, here are the expenses that we know we have to meet, and how are we going to fund that? How are we going to be able to meet that need to fill that budget? So that's how we do that, and so that's why we invite you to consider pledging. If you've never done it before, it's as simple as there's cards, and you'll get them in the mail, you get a letter, but you can also, they're always stacked out, and there's some now right outside the office window there. You merely are giving an estimate of what you think you were going to give the church this year. That's not a contract. No one's going to call you up and say, you know, hey, you know, you're 2% under, or you're 5% over, you know. No, that's not going to happen. This is between you and God. It just is a tool for us in our process of doing budgeting. So I want to encourage you to consider pledging. If you've never done it before, again, do not consider it as you're writing a contract with the church. You are not. What you're doing is giving us a way of understanding that side of the income side. Now, we do have some money that has been given to us that we'll see the fruit of in a couple of years' time. We estimate that by meeting our policy, we'll start having some income off of that that permanent investment in 2026. So for 2025, though we still have additional resources, we won't have that additional one. We'll tell you more about that and explain that to you, and you'll get letters about that. Since we're recorded, I don't want to go too much into it. But we do have plans, and we do understand that, and you will be kept apprised of that. Just suffice it to say that this year, 2025, we will not have the full benefit of the gifts we received. We'll have some of them, somewhat. So we still need you to be aware of that and treat this as you would any other year, this upcoming year in your giving, and we'll be just fine. We have trusted in you all for years and years and years, and you all have been faithful to that trust. So that's all I wanted to say about that and explain why you're seeing it and why you're getting them in the mail. And if you don't get one, and actually I've had people come up to me and say, why didn't you send me a pledge card? And I say, well, I don't send them, but that's neither here nor there. But what do you mean? We want a pledge too. And that's remarkable. So for those of you, if you don't get that letter and you don't get, they'll be always right out here on the by the little window to the office. You can just leave them in the offering box in the back, and that would be fine. Or you can send them in or drop them off. It's your convenience. Thank you for your attention. All right. I want you, if you would, to join with me in this. This is our call to worship. This is a very famous one. This is from Scripture. If you follow, you see the bold print and italics in the bottom. Come to Christ, that living stone, rejected by the world, but in God's sight, chosen and precious. And now for our songs, a couple are very short, so one we'll sing twice. We'll begin with Where the Spirit of the Lord Is, and we thank you, Jesus, and then for the beauty of the earth. And the words will be up here as well. be seated if you would. Well, yesterday was Veterans Day, and Veterans Day, you know, is celebrated in different ways, but not quite the way I remember when I was first a pastor. And on Veterans Day, we would have a really big deal in the town that I was in at that time, our family were in. And there would be a big program at school. Now, I know schools have done that, and they've had programs around that, and they still do. But in those days, I'd get asked to do those things. They'd want me to come and give a speech to the kids and to the parents and the families on this day, Veterans Day, mostly because of what it used to be known as. Do any of you know what it was called? I got to look at my dates. Armistice Day, that's right. And those of you who were around know that 1954 we started calling it Veterans Day. That's even before I was born. That's a long time ago, right? And we started calling it Veterans Day, but Armistice Day. It was because of the armistice, and that's where we get, you know, on the 11th hour, the 11th day, the 11th month, and that was in 1918. I got to check my notes anymore. That is when the armistice, which ended the hostilities of World War I, the armistice was signed in this train car in France. It was secret. The location was kept a secret. And I have some connection through my grandfather to that event. So they would want me to talk about that. And so as a pastor, I would come in. But we talked about more than just that. We talked about the meaning of the poppy, for example. Now, poppies are very common. In England, they celebrated yesterday Remembrance Day. They call it Remembrance Day because of the fact that they identify that we must not forget those people that gave their life in that Great War, as it was called. World War I was, at the time, was not called World War I. They didn't know there'd be a II. So it was called the Great War. They also had something very important. They believed that it was the war to end all wars. Imagine a war so terrifically, impactful on the world that when it was over, the people that had fought it, the nations that had been engaged in it, they said, this will end war because it's so terrible. It has cost so much in the way of lives, so many people from all these nations, an incredible amount of money and resources. It blew up all kinds of cities and changed the world, changed how people viewed their world too. A lot of change, including in theology after that war, the war to end all wars. Imagine being that optimistic. Coming out of something like that, of course, we live longer and we recognize, no, there was not many years later, I think 11 years later, World War II. My grandfather was in World War I, fought in that one. My father fought in World War II. Not that long ago in history. And World War II was so horrible, so terrible, that they said, you know, if we don't do something about this, we're going to see war after war after war after war. And after World War I, the idea came along, well, maybe if we just had a place we could all get together as countries and talk about it, we would solve that problem. That was the League of Nations under President Wilson. And the idea didn't catch on very well. It didn't really work out. But then came this terrible country. They said, we've got to do something. And we have the United Nations, which for a long time functions quite well in that regard. And, you know, so you know, imagine the concept of war. And if you go around America and if you the opportunity you look, you'll see there are many memorials to World War I, World War II, Korea, Vietnam, and now the other, you know, Desert Storm, all those. There are memorials in our nation's capital, for example. You can go there and find specific memorials to each of those particular events. Now, why do we do that? Are we trying to glorify the fact we had a war? Quite the opposite. I've had the chance. I've lived long enough, and I was old enough to have known veterans of World War I, veterans of World War II, veterans from Korea and the other conflicts. And, of course, that doesn't take now they're younger, but many of them are gone from us now. And many of them have passed. That generation that said, lest we forget, was what they said coming out of World War I, that we must have these things. So when you see these things, these monuments, and they show soldiers, I remember, you know, the one for World War I, it showed a soldier, like my grandfather was what they called doughboys, you know, it looked like a park ranger's hat, right? And those boots that came up to here. I saw his picture once, laced up, you know, all the way up here. And carried a gun with a bayonet. That's what he did. And, you know, he looked, his picture I saw of him posed looked like that. And they fought in a war that they thought would never be repeated. Now, he lived to see World War II and Korea and Vietnam. And I asked him one time in conversation, you know, he wouldn't talk much about the war. Actually, I found out most of what I know about him and his war, because he had all kinds of medals and stuff, was after he died at his funeral. Here comes this group of guys in a car. All of them looked like my grandpa, because they were all World War I vets, every one of them. And they got out the old gun, you know, I don't know, Al would know what those are called, that type of gun that they used in World War I. And they came with their guns, and they all lined up, and they sent somebody from somewhere to talk about what he had been a part of in that war. And so that's how I learned it. He wouldn't talk about it. When I talked to him one time, we were talking about war, and we're talking about it, and he was describing a terrible thing he was engaged in. He was a machine gun operator, those water cooled things. And he talked about that. And after it was over, I said, that's terrible. This was during the height of the Vietnam War and the protests in Madison, and I was like about 17 years old. That's a terrible thing. That's a horrible story. He said, it was. It was a terrible and horrible thing. It's haunted him all his life, because he took a lot of lives that day. For which the country rewarded him with medal, right? But he says, we really thought, we really believe that this would be the end of it. That peace would come out. Now, you're going to hear a lot of songs today about peace, and that's intentional. We're going to talk. He believed that he was there not fighting an enemy. By the way, who had many friends? He was born in Holland. You know, he knew many German folk, many French. And he said, we really believed that what we were doing would mean that you know, my grandson, but my son, we would never have to fight in another war. So when we think of soldiers, we shouldn't think about them just busting in the gut to get out there and start shooting at somebody and have all kinds of loads of fun. They literally realize, as those who have been engaged in wartime activities in particular, really understand that what they do to preserve or create peace. It's a whole other way of looking at it, isn't it? And that's what he wanted us to know, or wanted me to know, and I share with you now. So when we look back on Veterans Day, when we think about that, and we're honoring those who have served this nation, particularly those who've died, we do that on Memorial Day too, right, in a very special way. But today we think of all of those veterans who have served. So here's what I want you to do. If you're a veteran, I want you to raise your hand. Don't be shy. I know there's veterans. I can see it. Keep your hands up for a minute. Now, everybody else, I want you to look around and see. You have veterans in your midst who have served this nation. May we give them a round of applause and our thanks. So thank you. So I think it's an important day. I think we need to recognize it in the church. The poppy is symbolic, by the way, was adopted because of the red petals and the white center. They adopted because actually it had to do with a poem called in Flanders. There was so many of these folks were, after World War I, were buried in foreign soil. And when they visited those graves, poppies were growing. This is in Belgium. Poppies were growing all over. And they saw it and they said, that's reflective of the red to the cost of war and the white symbolic of the purity of cause. So very important thing, I think. All right. Now we're going to sing a selected. In our hymnal, it's called Eternal Father Strong. This is the Navy hymn. Now, we're going to think of our armed forces as having hymns. But they do. So I'm going to invite you to sing this. It's on 2191, the black hymnal. Words will be up here.
Thank you.
My dad was in the Navy. He never taught me that one. He taught me anchors away.
The scripture this morning is from Matthew 25, verses 1 through 13, from the New Revised Standard Version. The parable of the 10 bridesmaids. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 young women looked for their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took flasks of oil along with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight, there was a shout. Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him. Then all those young women got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise replied, not there will be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves. And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other young women came along also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he replied, truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour.
Before I turn to today's passage, I want to talk a little bit about something that's been said to me off and on over the years, here and there, because I am what people call a biblical preacher. That means that most of the time, 99.9% of the time, I'm going to talk to you about the Bible, about the passage we read or things of that nature, give you context to it, talk about its meaning. But the and sometimes people have said to me, you know, this is stuff that was written 2,000 years ago, some of it four. You know, what did they know about what it means to live in the now 21st century? What possible thing could somebody have to say to us? And what in the world? These stories we learned in Sunday school, you know, they're nice kids' stories. But why don't you talk about the more important things in life? Why don't you talk about the issues of the day? And my answer when that's come up every time is, every single Sunday, I'm talking about today. I'm using the past and what Jesus had to say to talk about what is happening in the world today. These are timeless words. And so when I tell you about a story like the 10 bridesmaids, I'm talking about what Jesus had to say, but the implication, the meaning behind it is as meaningful today as it was when he first spoke these words, and in this case, Matthew chose to write them down. Their meaning goes across time to this very day and are every bit as important now as they were then. So just to understand, every time I'm talking about here, when I'm reading here and I'm speaking here about this, I'm talking about today. So let's look at this passage now. This is the parable of the 10 virgins, it's called. That's because they were young women. They were part of a bridal party. You know, I've done a lot of weddings. To me, the bridal party has always been the whole bunch that come up here in front, right? The men, the women, the bride. But in those days, the bridal party literally were the ones that accompanied the bride. All right? So these are young women. And the young women, when they were getting married, were quite young. And so these were young women. And in this case, they're referred to as 10 virgins. It just should be an interpretation of the word means they were young women. All right? And so what happens is they've gone to this place. Now, some people say, well, it would have been the father's house, the father of the groom's house. Or it might be they were waiting in some other location near where the wedding would take place. But the point is they went to wait for the bridegroom to come. Now, how weddings worked in that day, a little different custom than today, is that when a couple became engaged, the young girl was probably 15 or 16 years old. The man, young man might have been 18, 20. That was common. And before they could get married, they were engaged. But before they could get married and actually live together, the custom was that the young man had to have a place for them to live. Now, oftentimes that means they would build an addition onto dad's house. Okay, that often happened. They'd get pretty large compounds. But they had to have a place where she could go to live with him, as well as any potential children they would have. And also, he was required to be able to be in a position to support not only the wife, but all the potential children they might have. So he had to demonstrate that he had a living he could make by whatever means, you know, whatever trade or craft he would be in. He had to be established enough to know that his income would be sufficient and they had a place to live. Now, that might take some of these young guys a few years, you know. And so when the time came, though, when the word was going to come that he was getting near to where he'd be ready, word was sent to the bride and the future bride and the family, the time is near. He'll be coming soon. And generally, they'd say he should be there, let's say, Tuesday at 12. Okay? He'd be showing up Tuesday at 12. So the bridal party gets together and waits. Now, they take lamps because these were big celebrations. They went into the night, you know. And plus, there could be a little delay there, but they were part of what they would do. It was like a procession, so just think of that. They would carry their lamps in procession to the place of the wedding. The wedding would take place. Then they would go in, and there'd be a big celebration. So that's what's going on. They're there waiting, and, you know, and there were 10 of them, and 5, you know, were called wise because they brought their lamps. And they filled their lamps, but they brought a flask of oil, just in case.
like good Boy Scouts, be prepared, right? If you were a Boy Scout, you learned that, be prepared. So they would bring a flask of oil. The other ones thought, yeah, I got my oil, it's full, plenty enough oil for the procession, we're good. Well, they get there and they're waiting, and they've got their lamps burning, because remember, that's their illumination, you know, their celebration, that they're burning their lamps, and it gets to be a little while and they get a little tired and they fall asleep. Pretty obvious, could happen. Some of them fall asleep, maybe all of them. And then it gets near on to midnight. They probably thought they were going to blow, you know, that would be the end of it. But then word comes. The bridegroom is now coming on the way to get you. He's coming. Midnight? It's kind of odd. Of course, this is an ironic twist. Remember I told you in Jesus' parables, there's always ironic twists. And you're supposed to say, well, that's kind of odd. What kind of guy comes at midnight to get the bridal party to go to a wedding? You're supposed to say, huh? Right? So, they get up and they get their, oh, they're waking up now. They got to get their lamps in good order. They trim them, which just means to bring the oil and get everything, you know, so it's bright illuminance. And some say, holy cow, we don't have much oil left. We're not going to make it. And they look at the other ones who are now filling their lamps with their little flasks. Say, wait, share with us, share with us. And they're saying, no, hold it. If we give you oil enough to get you and ours, we won't have enough for us to make it. And eventually, none of us will have any light. You go get your own. Again, you're supposed to say, at midnight? How many oil dealers are open at midnight in the ancient world? Probably not many. So they go, but rather than say, well, maybe we should just stay here. You know, what oil we got, maybe the bridegroom and they'll be graceful to us. Oh no, they run out and they go looking for this elusive, you know, all night whale oil shop that they're going to buy their oil from. They leave the place they were told to stay. That's important in this story. So they go off. Okay, along comes the groom. It's whatever. Let's say it's that now Wednesday morning at 12:05, and there he is. And they're all coming out with their lamps. And you might think to yourself, he might say, didn't you have 10? Maybe the bride notices that 5 aren't there. Of course. You're supposed to see that and say, that's strange, right? And where are they? Well, no time. The time has come. We need to go. The time has come. There's no waiting. You know, the waiting is over. The waiting was earlier. Now, we're never told why the bridegroom is delayed. It's just, again, this is an ironic twist. But so they go, and they go to the wedding, and they go to the place of the wedding. They go inside, and the door is shut and locked. Well, these bridesmaids, the 5 foolish, as they're referred to, apparently they either don't find oil or they find somebody to get oil from. We don't know. But they show up at the door and they knock in and they want in. And the householder says, you're too late. You're too late. Another ironic twist. Why would you say that? Why wouldn't you say, oh, come on in? You know, have you ever been late anywhere? I have. Would you have liked it if they said, oh, I'm sorry, you're 5 minutes late. You're out of luck. Well, that's happened to me too. But usually people say, oh, okay. You know, everybody gets delayed. Everybody can be late. You know, that happens. And we kind of just, in our day and age, it's sort of graceful to let somebody who's a few minutes late not lock the door on them and tell them, forget you. I think about a lot of Thanksgiving dinners where the dinner was ready and we were expecting family, and you know, got to the point where we couldn't wait anymore and we ate. And when they showed up, we didn't leave the door locked and say, oh, too bad, we already started eating, go home. No, we'd let them in and they'd make a plate and we'd receive them. That's what you would expect. So needless to say, when people read this particular parable, the two things that really get them is, why don't those bridesmaids share a little oil, and why did they lock them out? Because they were late. And it's to miss the entire point of the parable. Those are the ironic twists that's supposed to make you say, huh? Why indeed? So what I want to do is try to give you a sense of what this parable, why Jesus was telling it, and an important part is the context in which it is being told. He's telling this after telling several parables that come before that all deal with the same kind of idea. What happens when it becomes too late? He's talking about the return of Jesus Christ. Now, the second coming of Christ, we sometimes refer to that as, you know, a lot of people don't talk very much about that, but every time we have communion, that's what we say, the mystery of faith, remember? What's the last part? And Christ will come again. We all say it. It's as much a part of our faith as the first coming of Jesus is this concept that he will return at some point. And at that point, Jesus is saying, when that comes, here are these parables to try to understand what the kingdom of God is like, what it will be like in those days. So understand, he's talking about the time when he's coming back. So the bridegroom here that shows up at this ridiculous hour, unexpected, you know, long delayed, people getting irritated and some falling asleep, represents himself in this second coming, this return, which the scriptures attest to, Jesus spoke to. And he's saying there's a point there where it becomes too late. So let's look at these symbolism of the lamp and the oil. You know, what could that mean? I mean, you know, I don't have one of those lamps. I don't know if you do. You know, they kind of look like an Aladdin lamp. They're made out of clay. Usually the flame or fire came out of the center. Sometimes on the end, they like to show it that way, but commonly it was in the center, the wick. You can see why that might be. But what is that supposed to mean? Well, I want you to think of the metaphor. I think we can understand what this parable is teaching is by letting the oil represent one's spirituality. And defining that, saying one's relationship with God. How do you feel in relationship with God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit would be one way to say that. What is your relationship with God? How close do you feel to God on any given day or time? Think of that as being that oil inside. And the flame that burns, and that's an Aladdin's lamp style, it looks to me, but you see that flame over there? You know, that represents your faith, really. It's sort of the expression how we live our lives, right? So, you know, in our relationship with God. So the flame represents our faith in this case. It has many meanings, but let's use it for today for that purpose. So your oil inside is your spirituality. The result is the flame, which represents your faith. And your faith is, as I define it, is your what you believe that you put complete trust in. So faith is what we believe, sufficiently so that we put the entire trust of our lives and that of our families into it. That, for me, is what faith means. So that's faith. And so when they came to this time of waiting, they all had a lamp full of oil, right? You know, they filled them up. And they believed, you know, that was a reservoir. And that was going to get them through, right? It's going to get them through to the end. But what happens during the darkness hours, you know, and we use this light as a metaphor for knowledge, for the presence of God, the Holy Spirit. It's got all kinds of metaphor there too. But what happens when things are a little darker in life? Well, sometimes it's hard to keep that flame burning, isn't it? And it consumes oil. When the lamp burns, it's consuming oil. These candles back here have oil in them. And I can tell you, if you see them flickering and they start to, and then they sputter and go out, that's because we forgot to put oil on them. They were neglected. And then the light goes out. That works the same on these. There's a certain amount. So think of that spiritual relationship you with have God as fluctuates over life, doesn't it? I mean, do you always feel as close to God as when you maybe, as they say, first believed? Or somewhere God, you felt a deep and abiding connection with God. Maybe it was in prayer. Maybe it was at some event in life where you felt God was with you. That's pretty full. But what happens to us in life? Is it always like that? Hadn't been for me. There's times where it taxes that relationship severely sometimes. And if we don't tend to it, if we go through the entire life and we never really concern ourselves about where we are in that, you know, our oil. We haven't checked that lamp or whatever you will very often. And we don't have an extra flask sitting over here with oil in it. And we just go, oh, yeah, well, there you go. Now I feel good again. It doesn't quite work that way. Life, things that happen to us that challenge our faith come at various times in our life. And it's like that oil gets consumed. And if they're sufficient, the light stays bright. Fire keeps burning, right? But what happens if we don't? If we get tired, you know, I've been going to church so long. Or, you know, this stuff doesn't make sense to me anymore. He's up there telling another story of 2,000 years old, told by a bunch of primitive people. By golly, you know, good's that. And eventually we can maybe go so long with that that we end up like the foolish bridesmaids. The light isn't sufficient. The lamp starts, the flame starts to flicker and can even go out. What do you do then? Where do you go to the late night if it's midnight? Remember the ironic twist? It's the middle of the night. You've got a tremendous challenge before you. Let's not say it's the second coming of Christ. Let's say it that you're suddenly struck with the worst news you've ever heard in your life. The most painful thing that ever could possibly happen has happened. And you need that light. You really need that light. And you go to get it and you find that it is flickering. It's weak. It's out. What happens? Where do you go? Is there, you're going to be able to turn to the person next to you and say, hey, I'm out of faith here. Can you give me a little extra? My spirituality tank is empty and I'm really in a bad way. Can you come fill me up? Doesn't work that way, folks. You can't. Because this is your relationship with God, not mine or Aunt Ellen's or anybody else's. This is yours. That's your lamp. And what's in it is your oil. Your relationship with God. So when Jesus is telling this story, he's saying the most important event that ever will happen to the earth after creation and the first coming of Christ will be the second coming. And you need to be ready for that because there's a point where you no longer are going to be able to fill your reservoir, for the oil will no longer be available. He's saying there's a time that comes in the world when the door is closed. So he's warning, he's saying, don't wait until that most worst point in your life, the time when you need your faith the most, to worry about your relationship with God. Tend to it in the here and now, in the present, every day, every way, be seeing that that lamp is kept full. And how do you do that? The church has been talking about that for 2,000 years. You pray. You read the scriptures. You meditate upon them. You consider what it says to you and how it helps you to understand who you are in this world. It's like I was telling the confirmation class today, these stories that they maybe learned in Sunday school or we're talking about right now at other times, we might think they're just stories, but they build an entire world view. It creates a way of seeing yourself in the world in the present day or any time in your life or future. Is how we recognize the world to be what it is. And we understand things like what is right and what is wrong, what is good and what is not. These are how we know that, is through the worldview that we have in our very hands. If you've grown up in this country as a Christian person, or any other country as a Christian person, your worldview has been formulated in modern times by what is in this book. And what has been the moral teachings of the Christian faith in this particular nation in particular. That was the basis. And we're mostly here old enough to know that. There was a time where people did not take for granted their faith. They really thought it important that the kids ended up in Sunday school. They thought it really important that they learn these things. They thought it important that they be in a worship service, even if they fidgeted a little bit, you know, or threw Cheerios around like my kids did, and things like that. They felt it important. Why? Because they knew that this was how we understood the world. It really is, you know. You can study United States history, you know, and I have quite a bit, and you'll find that most of the people that were figuring out how this country should work had an understanding that there was a God above. They really did. You can read their writings. I have. The letters they wrote, the statements they made, If you base your knowledge of American history only on the Constitution and the Bill of Rights and some of the, those papers, you won't get the truth of history. History is not merely a collection of dates. This happened on this day. You know? Paul Revere rode his horse, right? You know that story? You know, who was he? You know, silversmith, you know? He was part of the revolutionary group that were trying to figure out what to do when the British showed up, you know? They had a lamp. It was filled with oil. Might not have been the same kind of oil you would prefer, but they believed in God, and they believed in the providence of God. That just means God's promises are fulfilled. Where did they get that? What was the first textbook at Harvard University when they created that university? It was created for the children of preachers because they wanted education clergy. You know what the first textbook was? What was the first textbook in the elementary schools when they first began having elementary schools and they taught kids to read and stuff? This is who we are. This is how we understand ourselves to be. When we neglect this, we lose the understanding of not only who we have been, we lose the understanding of who we are. And when we lose the understanding of who we are, we have no clue. No clue who we're going to become. But one thing we know in the study of history, world history, United States history, it's when we forget who we are, when we forget who we are, we lose the future. The future becomes irrelevant, and terrible things happen when people forget who they are. In Jesus' name, amen. The bells tell me I got to be done, so. If you'd sing with me this song, and then we'll conclude quickly after that. But this is Dear Lord, Lead Me Day by Day, 411 in the red hymnal, but the words are here. I have a couple prayer requests I want to share with you. This one is for a family member who wishes to be unnamed, is celebrating 5 years of being cancer-free from breast cancer, and has recently been diagnosed with a spot of cancer on the brain and other spot on their liver. So please pray for this person, for their mental and physical health. So this is just given to me. So please do keep this person in mind, and I'm going to keep this one too. So just remember that person. Pat Heinrich is in the hospital at St. Vincent's today. She was in intensive care, critical care last night. She had a fall. Don called and told me about it. She fell and she landed on her left side here and hurt her spleen. sufficient enough that they had to get her into intensive care. The family are down there. She's stable. We expect to hear more about that. So I'll be talking to him a little later today. But he said that he just would ask for prayers for Pat. So if you'd keep her in your prayers. And must have had a heck of a fall, you know, but that happens. And she's not that big of a person, you know. So, but it hurt the spleen. So please keep her in your prayers. There are prayer concerns in the bulletin. I invite you to always look to those. And remember to pray for people. And pray for yourself. You know, prayer is that gift we've been given to let God know what's in our hearts. So I'm going to invite us just for a very brief moment of quiet prayer, prayer, and then we'll pray our Lord's Prayer together. Let us pray. Merciful and loving God, we lift our hearts before you, our minds, in prayer this morning, and we give to you what is on our minds and in our hearts, the concerns of our day, the joys perhaps, and our thanksgiving, our gratitude for the life you blessed us with. Life, God, as you know, isn't always perfect. There are times where things are not so great in our own lives, in the world, and we hear of the concerns, we pray for those folks. We lift them up before you, those mentioned especially this morning, but all that we hold in our hearts. And we pray for our world that seems to be at such odds today. So many people are so angry, and there's such division. And literally, in this country, in so many countries, people are turning against each other and are so divided in their view and their understanding. And what we need is to be gathered together in peace. So many of those in our world, both men and women, have gone forward into places they didn't want to go, did things they didn't want to do, but they did them because in their hearts they believed it was the right thing to do, the necessary thing to do. Even if it meant they would lose their own life, they felt that they must. And why? So that there might be peace in the world. And there's been very little of that. And so we've asked so much of so many. And we owe so much to so many, especially in this nation when we think about what it means to be free. A dream that in many nations of the world is just that, a dream. We're so blessed in so many ways. But we owe that freedom not only to your commandment that all should be loved and cared for and all should be respected as individuals, but also to those for whom there was no other choice but to act in ways that were not peaceful so that we might know peace. We're grateful for them. We lift before you all of those who have gone forth in this nation and served it in any capacity, and with the desire and the intention of making it a better world for all. This is the goal, really, when we're at our best. So we ask your blessing on all of those living and gone from us. And we also ask your blessing on the concerns of our hearts and the needs of our lives, for you are God. And Jesus taught us one thing, absolutely with total clarity, that we matter to you, each and every one of us is loved by you. Each and every one of us is known by you. And each and every one of us has precious value to you. And you've said so much so that your Son came in the world to not only tell us that, but show it to us and give us that example and tell us that's how we ought to live, loving you and loving neighbor. So we thank you, God, for the blessings that you bestow upon this church. We thank you for the offerings given to this church and their use. We pray your blessing upon them as well, and that you would guide us in all things in accordance with your will, as we've been called to fulfill the mission of living in this world in such a way that people come to know who Jesus Christ is, what he taught, and welcoming them into the great church that looks to Jesus for all of these things, but mostly looks to Jesus as the Savior. In his name we pray and give our thanks, and now share our Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, So I did a little prayer of thanksgiving just for those. If any of you are visiting with us today or uncertain why you didn't get a plate passed, I mean, where do you go to a church, you don't get a plate. But what we do is we have a box in the back there marked offering. If you brought an offering and you wish to leave with the church, please deposit it into that box, and we'd appreciate that. We're going to just do just the refrain of Alleluia, Alleluia, and the words will be here. Now may God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, richly bless you, my friends. May you know the love of God. May you know the grace of the Son. May you know the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. For in these things we discover not only peace, but we discover love. We discover promise. We discover future. We know who we are by knowing who we have been. We know who we are in the future by knowing who we are now. May we live in accordance. May we truly keep the fire burning brightly. Because in these days we live, when it seems darkness is overtaking, that light shines brightly, and we will always find our way. In Jesus' name be blessed. Amen. And we will conclude with this song, 431. This song we need to sing, Let There Be Peace on Earth. Thank you, folks. Go in peace. God bless you.